Hello, and welcome to Thorlabs. My name is Amy, and I'm going to show you how to use a shearing interferometer to help collimate your coherent light source. I have here a little compact laser that's less than 2 milliwatts. I also have a series of 3 lenses, and we can use those to change the beam diameter. I have 2 shearing interferometers with a set of different accessories to measure the collimation of both small diameter and larger diameter beams. But let's first look at how a shearing interferometer works. If we send the input beam in from the left, we get a reflection off both the front surface and the back surface of the wedged shear plate. The 2 reflected beams partially overlap and interfere. We can view that interference pattern on the ground glass plate at the top of the device. We expect to see linear fringes, and when the input beam is collimated, the fringes will be aligned with the reference line on the ground glass. As you move away from collimation in either direction, converging or diverging, the fringes will rotate with respect to the reference line. I want to point out that if the shear plate is thick and the beams are smaller, then you actually won't get any overlap at the ground glass plate on the top of the device. In that case, there is no interference pattern to indicate whether the input beam is collimated. It is important to make sure the beam size matches the recommendation of the shear plate you're using. Because the device uses interference to operate, it can only be used to test the collimation of a coherent light source. All right, let's play in the lab. First of all, I'm going to take my laser source and I'm going to put a lens in front of it so I can focus the beam. Tighten this up. So now I have a beam that's traveling down the rail. Going through a pretty tight focus and expanding out into space. So we need another lens to collimate this because we are testing our collimation. I'm going to start with the lens mount here, attach that to the rail, and I'm going to pick out one of my other lenses. I'm going to pick the longer lens, so this is a relatively long focal length lens, so we'll get a relatively large beam. I'm also using my larger shear plate for measuring the collimation of a larger beam. So I've just put this in randomly. This is not in the right position, and I'm actually pretty close to the focus. So if I look at my shearing interferometer, I do see 2 circles, but they're just fuzzy now. I'm not seeing any of the interference fringes we talked about. So I'm going to move this farther away, and as I get farther and farther away from the focus, I start to see some fringes appear. And as I keep getting closer to the point of best collimation, those fringes rotate until they are aligned parallel to the black line on top of the shearing interferometer. As I move back closer to the focus, they rotate towards me and get smaller and closer together. Eventually, as they get so close together, I can't see them anymore. So that's what I'm seeing when I'm very far away from best collimation. I can see these fringes line up. This is telling me my beam is well collimated at this point. And let's see what happens when I get a little farther away as well. So I go farther away. The fringes are now rotating clockwise. They're rotating sort of away from me. And they're getting smaller and closer together again. And so this tells me, gives me some feedback on whether or not I'm too far away from the focus or too close to the focus. So I know I'm too far away here. I'm going to back up a little bit and I'm going to line this up so that it's directly lined up with the line on top of the shearing interferometer. Another thing that you need to pay a little bit of attention to here is your beam quality. We have some really, really nice fringes here, but if there are any problems with your beam quality, if you have any sort of aberrations, any wavefront errors, you are going to see these fringes start to get messed up and your signal doesn't work anymore. You can't use this for collimation. Just as a quick example, I'm going to use just a clear plastic box and put this into our large beam. And if we take a look at our fringes on the screen, they get pretty squiggly. I do not have straight fringes anymore. I cannot possibly line these up with a line. So if I have significant aberrations on my beam, any significant wavefront errors, I am not going to be able to use this device to collimate my beam. At that point, I probably need to look back at what is causing the aberrations in my laser or my light source, or I might then decide to use a different collimation method. So let's also look at what happens with a smaller beam. I'm going to take this lens out and replace it with a shorter focal length. And so I should have a smaller beam. Now this shearing interferometer is designed for a larger beam diameter. So it is not designed for the smaller beam, and I expect it won't work. But I'll have to see what it looks like. All right, so as expected, I have a smaller beam coming in here right now, and the two reflections off of this thick plate are not overlapped. So I'm not seeing any interference. I can move back closer to my focus. That should get me closer to collimation with my shorter focal length. As I go through, I see these beams stay pretty small. Eventually they overlap, but I'm not seeing any fringes. So my point of collimation is probably not anywhere where these beams are overlapped. This is not unexpected. I should use a smaller shear plate. So I'm going to take this shear plate out and I'm going to put it away carefully. It has glass sticking on the back. I'll make sure I don't damage that. And then I'm going to reach over and get my smaller shear plate that has a smaller aperture. Put that on here as well. And so now I can see these beams are overlapped. And it's possible I can see some fringes, but gosh, they're really, really small. I can't really tell what I'm looking at. So what we do when we have a smaller beam like this with real tight fringes is we can use this magnifying screen. So I'm going to remove this shearing interferometer and put this off to the side for a moment and transfer in this other version. This has a magnified viewing screen on the top of it. So there's a lens in here, and then the ground glass is up here at the top. So now I can take that little tiny signal and make it bigger. I do need my shear plate. So let me put that back on here. And again, I'm off a little bit in my alignment, but oh, cool. I have a pretty bright signal up here. I can see lots of overlap and my fringes are very, very clear, nice and big. And it looks like I'm actually pretty close to alignment. I'm going to move this just a little bit. This is my point of best alignment. And we can show here too, as I go too close to the focus, it rotates counterclockwise again. And as I go too far away from the focus, it rotates clockwise. So I'm getting the same signal because the size beam I have here and the distances I'm looking at is a little bit more sensitive. I don't have to move very far. Shearing interferometers are a really great tool to do a quick test of the collimation of your light source. They work if you have a coherent enough light source to do interferometry, if you have minimal wavefront errors so you can get nice fringes, and if you have made sure that the beam size that you're using is well matched to the shear plate that you've chosen for your shearing interferometer. If all of these are true, you throw this in, you do a quick adjustment of your lens, you're collimated, and you're ready to go. This is, however, just a qualitative tool. If you want quantitative information on your beam, I would suggest using something like a beam profiler or a wavefront sensor. I hope this has helped your application, and if you have any further questions, please contact tech support.